You know, Lernerville Speedway is a pretty special place for Don Gamble. I've been coming here since the track opened. Had a chance to race here for a lot of years. Worked as the on-track announcer. Really enjoy my Friday nights, but I always look forward to the Don Martin Memorial. And two people that are going to be a big part of this, General Manager Gary Risch and announcer Dale Carnahan. We'll start with Gary. Gary, you got to be pleased. The weather's nice. Good crowd. The best drivers in the country here. What do you think?
Man, I'm pretty excited. I mean, there's a lot of work that goes into this last month with the Firecracker 100 and Silver Cup, Don Martin Silver Cup that comes up. So I'm real excited for this time of the year, and we got a great field of race car drivers in the pits right now, and the fans are rolling in, and finally a beautiful night. Don Martin has blessed us with a beautiful night, and we're real excited to put on some great racing.
You know, this is a very prestigious race, and over the 20 years, it has become a must race for the sprint car guys. But what's happening with the Firecracker is pretty special, too. It's building every year, more cars, more people, more campers, and a lot of happy fans. So.
It is. It's fan-oriented, and it's all about the event. Same deal with this stuff. It's not the same because it's a one-night event, and with the Firecracker being a three-night event, people make that their stop. I mean, they're choosing to come to Lernerville Speedway and being a part of the Firecracker, and it's pretty awesome.
Dale, you're here every Friday night, but you really get fired up when there's a special show in town.
Oh, everybody does. It's great to see, you know, we don't get to see these guys race all the time because we're here every weekend, but you read about them, you watch them on TV or YouTube or whatever, and when you see them all come into the pits and you get here and you say, yeah, this is fun, and this is why we do it.
I've been watching you work for a lot of years, and when people ask me to describe the way you do things, I said, when he's announcing, it sounds like he's sitting beside you, you're the only two people there, and he's telling you what's going to be important in that race. And that's a pretty special quality in an announcer. You're not a screamer. You don't go through mundane things. You make the people feel like they're part of the program.
Well, you probably have to talk to those right people then, because I'm sure there's some people that wouldn't agree with you. But I don't know. I think when you're announcing, you're just being yourself. That's what I'm being. I'm a fan of racing. I would have been here. I was at the races long before I became an announcer. I love it, or I wouldn't be here doing it. And I think the fans enjoy it. And I just try to help them through the night. Give them a little tidbit here, a little tidbit there. Have some fun when it's warrants, and maybe be a little serious when it warrants as well. But I don't know what my style is, but it's just me.
It's very smooth. And, you know, I've been to races where I'd see you sitting in the stands, you know, stop over. Hey, what's this, a bus driver's holiday, you know? But I think because you're part of the racing community, when you do the announcing, you know a little bit of some of the stories about these folks. You're always in the pits. I see you going around getting tidbits, news items, new drivers, something, maybe the driver's family, something significant happened, a wedding, a graduation, a baby. That's why people like to listen.
Well, that's important. I mean, you know, these people in the stands don't get a chance to meet a lot of the drivers or get to know them personally, but they are their heroes in a way. I mean, you know, here on a Friday night even, there are diehard fans for certain drivers, and that's what makes this place so special. I've never worked at a racetrack where when the cars come through the gate at the pits at 5 o'clock and the fans come into the stands, it's just like this whole community comes together, and I don't think there are too many places in America that have what we have right here.
From time to time, he might announce something where one of these diehard fans doesn't like what he said.
I've seen that.
And you have to take the heat.
Yeah, I do take the heat. I guess that's where my job comes into play. But like Dale said, I mean, you have your diehard fans that will sit in the stands and fight with the guy next to you because he's a Flinter fan and he's a Lynn Geisler fan. And they each have their own T-shirts on it. It's really a great deal to be a part of this. I mean, this is my seventh year with the company here, and I mean, I guess time flies when you're having fun, but what a great place to work, and like Dale says, you just love your job, and I love what I do, and I love being a part of Lernerville Speedway.
You mentioned the fans. Now, a lot of them have a special seat.
Yes.
And if someone else is in their seat, you got another problem.
I do. I had a problem with the Firecracker we were talking about where people were saving their seats ahead of time, and they saved someone else's seats. He says, I don't care. I'll come in 3 weeks earlier and save my seat then. You try to make everyone happy, and then sometimes it's impossible, but we still try to talk with Kyle about the way Don Martin used to do things, and you know, we try to do it in these economical times the best we can, but there's only one Don Martin, and there will only be one Don Martin, and we try to we try to keep our keep the history and everything that we can alive here, and try to move on with the economic times and the new ways of things.
Well, I'll give you a tip. So you have the shirt on, okay? Years ago, I was the pit steward, and Ed Lynch Jr. was racing, and Senior was over at the fence. Something happened. Senior didn't like it. So he came over, one of eight trips back and forth, called me everything but Dawn, okay? And I just kept saying, when it's over, we'll talk. Finally, he came over, said, I can't get you mad. I said, no. He said, but I want to tell you something. If you're going to wear the shirt, you're going to listen to me. So if you're wearing a shirt, get ready. They're going to listen to you.
I'm pretty used to it by now. But the nice part about it is you got the people that come up and thank you for what you do, too. I mean, and whenever those cars roll on the track tonight at 8:15 for time trials, and you sit back and you see that sun shining and that full grandstands, that's what it's all about. It's all about the racing. It's all about the fans. It's all about everyone coming here and spending their entertainment dollar at Learnerville Speedway because they love the World of Outlaw race cars and they love Learnerville Speedway.
Outlaws or Friday, the greatest people in the world come through those gates.
Without a doubt.
You know, Dal, Kyle asked me if I had a favorite after we got done talking about food. I wouldn't begin to predict a winner.
No, man. I just was down through the pits. This may be the best field of cars we've ever had assembled here for the Don Martin Silver Cup. I mean, not only do we have the World of Outlaws best, and let's figure they're the best in the world, but there's quite a collection of cars from Central Pennsylvania, probably as many as we've ever had for one event. Then you've got the top two guys with the All-Stars, Timmy Schaefer and Dale Blaney. You've got Ed Lynch, you've got Danny Holkraver, and the rest of our local contingent. There's some guys from Australia, and there's a couple of other guys down there. We want to talk about them now?
Sure. Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Tony Stewart and Casey Kane, I mean.
Yeah.
Why, was it a secret that they're here?
Well, they don't like to tell us until this morning that they're coming, but Casey Twittered this morning, and I talked to Tony last Tuesday at Sharon, and he gave me the, I'm probably going to be there, but I'm not sure yet. But, yeah, Tony Stewart's here, and he's really excited. I was just in there talking to him, coming off the King's Royal, finishing 10th there. I mean, he was pretty excited to be a part of it. Now, him and I had it out a little bit about him racing at his own track, since I'm not allowed to race at my own track. And I told him he wasn't allowed to race at his track. He said, well, you just work for your track. He said, I own my track. I'll do what I want.
And, you know, Tony's mentioned several times that – he would rather race sprint cars, but he has to earn a living, so he does the NASCAR stuff so he can do what he really loves. And I believe Casey Kane is probably in the same boat.
I agree with you. You know, Tony and I have become pretty good friends, and you know, it's pretty funny that he's talking about when he retires from NASCAR being a full-time sprint car driver. I mean, what better retirement job is there? I mean, most people are greeters at Walmart, but Tony's going to drive sprint cars.
You know, Dal, I was down for the Lou Blaney Memorial, and Casey and Tony were both in there, and they're top-notch drivers, but they had to work cut out for them. He pulled off the win. Dave Blaney was third, another Cup driver there, but I think Danny Holtgraver finished in front of Kane and Stewart.
Yeah, they're good, let's face it. How many guys can jump from a 3,500-pound NASCAR car on a mile-and-a-half racetrack and into 1,100-pound sprint car on a half-mile dirt track and go around there like they've been doing it their whole life? But these guys that do it week in and week out, I mean, man, just think of the laps that the Steve Kinzers and the Sammy Swindells and the Donnie Schatz, and I'm just naming a few, have turned. I mean, yeah. And you know, they're so sharp, and they're so good, and the competition here is so – you know, you look down through the differences in the finish. I mean, there's nobody's won more than five times. And they've got like six or seven that have won at least three. I mean, it's just really, it's probably the most competitive season right now they've had. And just wish Joey Saldana could be here. That's a real shame. It's 2 years in a row. Last fall, Learnerville.
Yeah. Let's talk about Danny Holtzgraver, though.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, Danny Holtzgraver come from here of our champion last year. And, man, has that kid come into his own in the last few months.
We talked to him earlier in the show, and, you know, he's got it together. And he thanked Timmy Schaefer. Well, Timmy has become his mentor. And quite a good friendship there has developed over the years. And, you know, and he says the best part about Danny is he listens.
Yes.
Well, I think, that's one thing about him. He's pretty level-headed kid as far as that's my impression of him anyway. He doesn't seem to get too high or too low, and he's very even keel.
If anybody was at Pittsburgh Motor Speedway and watched him patiently reel in Ed Lynch Jr., and that doesn't happen, folks.
No.
That does not happen.
No.
And it looked like that kid's been driving as long as Ed Lynch Jr. is. And his patience and No one wanted, and his focus is unbelievable for his age. And I'm really proud to be at Learnerville Speedway and be a part of Danny Holzgraver's career.
He had a little bit of a mountain to climb where he had a bad wreck here.
Yes.
And he was snake bit, but I don't know when it turned around, Dahl, but something clicked, and boy, he's been in victory lane ever since.
Well, he only went twice here, but he last year it seemed like from the middle of the season on, he could not finish out of the top five. He was five, fifth, third, second, and fourth, and it was only a matter until he got his first win. And then, like Gary said, it just seems like his confidence is built. But he's very patient. In fact, when he won here Friday night, if you remember, he was running third the first six or seven laps of the race. And I said, man, he's just kind of sitting, you know, stuck. Yeah. Like, I said, maybe his car's not that good. And then the caution came on. There was a restart. And he said, okay, it's time. And poof, he was gone. And
yeah.
I even said to him, Victor Lane, I didn't think your car was that good. And he said, no, I was just being patient.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, you look at him at the Lou Blaney Memorial. He started about 10th or 12th or something like that. He was the only car going forward. I mean, it was a lap at a time, car at a time. And the kid's going to – I really feel that he could be our next – star that comes out of Western Pennsylvania.
Well, I can't be specific, but there's big plans coming for Danny, and when they come, you'll be shocked. You know, his dad's very supportive of the team. He's got a good crew, bunch of young guys, and then some of the older fellas help out. They work on that car day and night. I don't know how they find the time, but when it comes to the track, it's ready to go. It's not one of them deals where we'll fix it when we get there. It's ready to go. It rolls out of the trailer, and it's good.
Hey, you talk about Danny being the next guy to come out of Western Pennsylvania. I don't know if there's any track in America that has produced guys that have gone on one track that's produced. When I think of Timmy Schaefer, a track champion here, Brad Doty, a track champion here, Ed Lynch Jr., a track champion here, who's won with the Outlaws.
Dave Blaney,
not a track champion, but a many-time winner here. Dale Blaney. Yep. I mean, there's a lot of guys that cut their teeth in Western Pennsylvania and have gone on not only big things regionally, but done a really, really good job. You know, Schaefer's won this race. He's won the Knoxville Nationals. Brad Doty won all over America before his injury. Ed has represented us so well. And the Blaneys, I mean, what can you say about them? Dave's won everything, and Dale is no slouch either, let's face it. He's very capable of another car could win this race here tonight. So,
well, I think Dave and Dale were destined to be good drivers because their dad, Lou Blaney, multiple-time champion here, one of the greatest drivers ever to put a helmet on. He did a lot of wins in the sprint cars, but then when Dave wanted to race, he got out of the sprint, got into the modified, and continued 600 and so victories. I can recall one night when Lou came into the pits. There was two young kids pushing the car, Dave and Dale Blaney, and who would have thought that they would have found the success they have today?
Lou Blaney, what a great person. You know, I raced big block modifieds for about 10 years before I took on this promoter thing. And, you know, Lou was definitely the guy you looked up to, you know. And I can remember a story of me passing him one night at Mercer. And I looked at myself and I thought, I'm like, man, this isn't supposed to happen.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what did I do? And, you know, he put his arm around me at the end of the race and you know, walked out to me and said, kid, you're finally getting it together here. I said, you just got to teach me your patience. He said, you just got to learn that long time coming, bud.
You know, Dahlin, there's a third generation, Ryan Blaney, but he's in a full-bodied car on the asphalt.
On the asphalt, Dave's son down in North Carolina. Yeah, and it sounds like he's grabbing a lot of attention of some of those, you know, NASCAR teams down there that may sign him to be a developmental driver pretty soon because he's, what, 14?
Yeah.
15, something like that. When you start winning races at that age, you know, Bill Elliott's son, it seems like they want you. They want you now.
Yeah.
Well, if it's anything like his dad, I can remember Tony Stewart telling me one time that Dave Blaney is probably the best research and development driver that NASCAR has. He can bring so much back to the table from the testing and stuff like that, of new cars and new parts and stuff like that, than any other driver on the circuit.
We need to wrap this up. Is there anything we missed?
Not at all. We're excited for tonight and hope everyone gets out here and checks out this great racetrack and this great race we're going to have.
20 years. That's the thing that's amazing. When you said that earlier, and I thought about that on the way up here
20
today.
20 years.
20 years of the Don Martin Silver. It's hard to believe. Hard to believe.
People tease me about being old, but I've been to all of them. I'm old. All right. Dahl Carnahan, the voice of the Learnerville Speedway, and Gary Risch, Jr., the general manager. Thanks for being with us.
Thanks a lot,
Thank you, Don.